Bueno, pues bienvenidos a todos a un nuevo seminario de programas de estadística y optimización y matemática aplicada. En este caso tenemos con nosotros al profesor Vito Fragnelli de la Universidad de Piamonte Oriental, Amadeo Avogadro, que hoy nos va a hablar sobre índices de poder. Su currículum pues incluye publicaciones tanto en problemas de sistemas políticos, como donde caería esta charla de los índices de poder, bancarrota, asignación justa, análisis de seguros y reaseguros, etc. Y ha publicado pues más de 70 trabajos en esos campos. Además es una persona que está muy implicada siempre con la difusión y la formación en teoría de juego, y por eso organiza y dirige una escuela de verano en Campione de Italia, en la que siempre es teoría de juegos y algo más. En una ocasión en teoría de juegos y telecomunicaciones, pero bueno, cada año pues se dedica a una temática en la que la teoría de juegos pues tiene su aplicación. Entonces bueno, tienes ya la palabra. Muy contento de que estés aquí con nosotros y espero que os guste.
Muchas gracias a todos por ser aquí. Me decía Joaquín que necesita que hablo en inglés o otra lengua que no es el español. El italiano me gustaría muchísimo, pero parece que no es bueno. Okay, we can start. And first of all, I want to thank, of course, Joaquín that invited me for this very nice stay in this very nice place. And when I speak of very nice place, I mean the scientific aspect related to this university and the touristic aspect related to the surrounding Alicante, and not only Finestrat, for instance, Villa Gioiosa is something like this that I enjoyed a lot during this period here. Okay, of course, I have also to thank all of you for being here. I hope that this talk will be interesting for you. I try to be not so much formal. Maybe you are not so accustomed with details of game theory, but of course, if any one of you have questions, you can raise in any moment. Don't feel feel free, please, to pose any question in any moment. You can interrupt. It is not a problem for me at all. Okay, I think that I can start. This is more or less what I will say you. The first is clearly which problem we analyze. The second is some basic elements of game theory that can be useful for formalizing what I am saying later. Then there is a survey of some power indices, of course. To present all of them, it is in a sense impossible, first of all because I don't know all the power indices that there exist, and also the time, clearly. At the end, I pose something that is, in a sense, an open problem. So maybe some one of you could be interested in thinking to this possibility. Okay. What is the setting in which we pose the so-called 0-1 decision problems? What is a 0-1 decision problem? It is a situation in which we have to solve a problem whose answer is simply to say a proposal or something equivalent to a proposal, a law if we are speaking about a parliament or something like this, can be approved or not. And the agent, or the decision makers, if you prefer, are asked to say, I am in favor or I am against. They have no other possibilities of this. Just to mention, this is a classical approach to this topic, and I decided, I said you, to make something enough simple. But there are some people here in Spain, in Manresa, Joseph Freixas, and not only him, that is working from sometimes about a situation in which the agents can express a different level of approval for the situation that they are facing in that moment, and also the result can be not only yes or no, but also something intermediate among the two. So this just to say that the set in which we are is extremely wide. So a lot of things can be done, and a lot of things were already done, even if I don't speak about them in this talk. So what is the main problem that when we speak about power indices we are interested in? Is this one. If we have the different members that can be in favor or against the proposal, which is the relevance, just to use, or the influence that they have in the final decision. Of course, this is much more important how much the members are not equivalent. For instance, if we think to the parties in a parliament, it is clear that not all the parties have the same strength, simply because they have a different number of seats. But not only, it is also maybe can depend from other elements. The same a set of stakeholders. Of course, not all of them own the same amount of stocks. So if I have more stocks, probably I am able to exercise a stronger influence on the final decision. And so on. These are the main points. Clearly, if we think again to a parliament, in a very simple frame of mind that can be made more interesting, and I will present something about this, the members are in a sense equivalent, because anyone can express exactly one vote. So apparently they have the same influence. The word apparent will be clear in two or three slides. Okay, this problem to determine the influence of the agent, of course you can think to this in a lot of ways, but in game theory we speak about power indices. Okay, so these are the minimal instruments that I think that are necessary to formalize what I am going to say later. The first is what is a cooperative game in characteristic form. It is a pair in which N represents the set of agents or players, with the game theoretic meaning, and V is what is called the characteristic function, with the condition that for the empty set the characteristic function assigns value 0 to the other coalition. Oh, this means to the other subset of N, it assigns an amount Vs that is interpreted as the worth of the players when they act alone. Among the possible cooperative games, there are a class that is called the simple game, and these simple games are the games in which the characteristic function may assume only value 0 or 1. So, in order to simplify the words for considering these topics, we speak about winning coalition when the worth of the coalition is 1 and losing coalition when the worth of the coalition is 0. The idea is very suitable for our setting, because winning means that they succeed in approving the proposal, losing means the opposite, they are not able to approve the proposal. We said that a simple game is proper whenever this condition holds. What does it mean? If a coalition is winning, it is supposed that the remaining agents involved in the situation are not able to be winning the same. Of course, suppose any situation in which there is a proposal supported by S and the counter proposal supported by M minus S. If you have not this condition satisfied, it is possible that the two proposals are approved the same. So it is necessary that the game is proper, of course. Otherwise, it is possible to have a very bad situation. Not all the games are proper. And this is reasonable in a sense. Sometimes you are required not to give a final decision about a topic, but simply to make something like a filter of some proposal. Some proposal will be discussed later, some other no. In this case, for instance, it is possible that this condition is not satisfied. This means that a proposal by yes and the counter proposal are but discussed by the assembly, for example, or whatever it is. Of course, in the final decision, it is required that the resulting game will be proper. This means that only one of the two can be accepted, or better, at most one of the two. It is possible that both of them are rejected, of course. Usually, but it is not mandatory, we ask that the game is so-called monotonic. This means that if a coalition, a group of agents, is able to approve, to pass a law, or to take a decision, a larger set of players is able to do the same. And often we ask that at least the so-called grand coalition, this means if all the members of the assembly are in favor of the proposal, this is passed. This is the minimum requirement. Sometimes this hypothesis is not satisfied. This is another story. Okay, another thing that can be useful is what we call the weighted majority situation, that of course has nothing to do with game theory. It is the preliminary step in a sense. We have a set of decision makers, in a sense we have the equivalent of the players. Each of the decision maker is characterized by a weight. You can think to the number of stocks that they have if they are stakeholders, or you can think to the number of seats of the different parties in a parliament, or whatever you want. For any reason, for instance, I apologize because I am not so accustomed with the situation in Spain. So I will make some example taken from Italian situation. I'm very sorry, but for going in some details, I think that it is not enough to pass yesterday or 1 week reading something on the network, but you should live in a country to know all this aspect. Why I say this? Because, for instance, in a lot of decision situation in Italy, if there is an assembly, the president of the assembly has a double weight with respect to the all other members, only if there is a tie in the decision. So the president is decisive in a sense. So not necessarily has the double weight, but for the tie it has. This is just to say how complicated could be the models that we have to consider. And finally, the number two is what is called the majority quota. This means the sum of the weights of the decision maker that are in favor of the proposal should reach at least the majority quota. At this point, it is very easy, given a weighted majority situation, to define what is called the weighted majority game. Simply, we use the set of decision maker as set of players, and we construct the characteristic function using the weights, exactly as I said before. If the sum of the weights of the members of a coalition is at least the majority quota, the coalition is called winning, otherwise it is called losing. Another point that it is nice, in my opinion, to make clear before going on is that usually in game theory, S is any group of players, of agents of the situation. In this case, we add implicitly an additional hypothesis. If I am a member of a coalition, it is supposed that I am in favor of the proposal. In fact, when I define the worth of a coalition, implicitly I add the weight of the agents that are in this coalition. Of course, it is not necessary. It is like I said, you are a coalition, you are a group, a subset of this set of decision makers, but nobody says that all of you are in favor. And in general, when I am speaking about a coalition, I say that this is a coalition that has a given word. So, in a sense, I have to consider a subset, and I have to ask to any of the members if you are in favor or not, and I have to sum only the weights of the members that are in favor. This is clearly something to make the things simpler. It is more easy to suppose that when I consider a set of agents, they are in favor, nothing else. But it is, in a sense, a strong hypothesis. Not necessarily when I consider a subset of agents, they are all in favor. Okay. Now I start with a survey. So I will present you some power indices that are used very often in game theory, and some others that are used a little bit less for various reasons. What is important to specify at this point is this word, in the sense why we have so many power indices. It is not a problem of ranking them. So I have no idea here to give you a ranking of the power indices. It is difficult to say, it is impossible to say this is the best power indice. Simply, you have to decide, given the situation that I have to face, which is among the existing power indices, or you can define a new eventually, if you like, or if you need, the better that takes into account all the particular aspects involved in that situation that we are considering. According to this, I can say that a given power index is good or it is not so good as I want. Clearly, the possibility to easily compute it is a strong aspect in favor of using a power index. Of course, this is classical, especially if you have a lot of agents. It is difficult to take into account everything and to make very hard or very strong, from the computational point of view, computations. So sometimes the solution is to use a power index that it is easy to compute, nothing else. But if the situation is very bad for that index, it is better to avoid it. Okay, here you have several names, but we have to distinguish among two groups. The first group includes this three person, the second group includes these two other person. And they have provided two power indices. This one have small differences among one the others, so I put all together just to make the thing simple. What is in common for these two indices, or these two groups of indices? The idea that a decision maker is able to change the result of a voting session simply staying or not in a coalition. With the hypothesis that I said before, that the coalition, all the members of the coalition are in favor. So when he decides not to stay, he decides to leave him from the coalition, it is clear that he passed from the idea of approve the proposal to the idea of reject the proposal. Okay, this is the common idea of these two groups. If we want to formalize this idea, we can introduce the concept of swing. What is a swing? Is given a winning coalition S, suppose that a player I, that belongs to S, leaves, decide to reject the proposal, and the proposal is rejected. After the concept of swing, it is easy to introduce the concept of the criticality of an agent. In this situation, player I is critical for S. Because if he belongs to S, S is winning. If he leaves, S is losing. Clearly, an agent could be critical for a coalition and not for another one. Not necessarily an agent is critical for all the coalition. Sometimes it happens. In this case, it is called a dictator. In the sense that whenever he is able to pass a law if he is in the coalition, or not to pass if it is not in the coalition, it is a dictator. A little weak concept is the so-called veto player, that is a player that is necessary in order that the coalition is winning, but it is not enough that it is in the coalition. So, if it is not in the coalition is surely losing, but if it is in the coalition, not necessarily the coalition is winning, so it is not critical for this coalition. In a sense, we can say that a dictator is critical for any coalition. That includes SIM, of course. Using the idea of a swing, we can represent in this way the first index. And in this point, you can see the main difference that there exists among these two indices. The first simply considers the swing with respect to the coalition that includes player I. This is a weight that it is assigned, and it is simply the number of coalition to which I is member of. So in a sense, this is the average of the swing that can involve player I. You consider all the possible coalitions, sometimes is able to have a swing, some other times no. On the average, you have the power of this agent. If you sum up all the values of beta for all the agents, not necessarily obtain one, so sometimes it is better to normalize the index. It is simply normalized in this way, a very simple operation. But nothing changes in a sense. If you like, you can say that this is a more relative value, this is more absolute. But sometimes it is better to have this before to make comparison with other power indices. What is the main difference among this index and this one? In a sense, we have the same. It is the average of the swing that player I is able to produce, but not taking into account all the coalitions. We take into account something more. We take into account the ordering in which the players, in a sense, form the coalition. What is the idea, more or less, behind the Shapley-Shubik index and the Banzhaf index, just to say it simply? Here you consider all the possible coalitions that exist in a parliament, for instance. And you simply say, okay, this is a winning coalition, this is not. I am critical for this coalition, I am not critical for this one. Nothing else. Here, not only take into account which are the coalition that are winning or not, but you take into account also how the members form this coalition. Just to make an example, suppose that I am asking you, you are in favor or against a proposal, and I start with Joachim and say what he wants. Going on, at a certain moment, I don't know exactly how much you are, there is someone that say, I am in favor, and we are over the majority quota. Clearly, this agent is the unique that is critical in this situation. Because up to that agent, the proposal was rejected, I do not collect enough yes for the proposal. If I collect other yes in the following, among the following decision makers, it is nothing. I already have the approval of the proposal. But why to say that agent is critical? It is simply a question of chance. He was lucky, in a sense, that I asked him in the right moment, you are in favor or not. The idea of taking into account all the possible ordering is just introduced for this reason. I don't want to take into account the chance, but something that is more objective, more mathematical in a sense. So I make the average on all the possible ordering in which the agents can be asked if you are in favor or not. Clearly, this is a little bit more complicated. But, of course, in some situation, the ordering is very important, so it is better to use this index. Some other times, it is not so important, the ordering, so it is better to use the Banzhaf index. So, we cannot say this is better or this is better. The ordering is important, this is better. The ordering is not important, this is better. Because we introduce something that it is not required, or we forgot something that is important. Okay? What is the main question that is raised against these indices? The idea is more or less the following. With a political example, it is very easy. Suppose that the members are the parties in a parliament. When I speak of a coalition, here, or simply in the ordering that I am taking into account here, there is a moment in which I consider among all the possible coalition that includes a player, or among the possible ordering, and I consider the players up to the player I. In this subset of parties, where are the most left parties and the most right parties? Of course, the idea that is behind the concept of swing simply takes into account these matters. I sum the weights, I sum the number of members of each party, the number of seats. But it is clear that it is very hard that two parties that belong, one to the extreme left and the other to the extreme right, are in favor of the same proposal. But I take into account this situation, but it is completely out of mind in a lot of situations. In Italy we speak about transversality of vote. Sometimes there are some situations in which it is not important if you are from the left or from the right. It is something that involves other elements not strictly related to politics. But also in this case, it is clear that if you belong to a party, in a sense, it is reasonable that you vote in a given way. So, these two very important persons, Myerson, he got the Nobel Prize, just to say. Owen didn't go to the Nobel Prize, but it is very close in a sense. In the same year, this is another aspect that is interesting to notice, introduced something that takes into account that the agent cannot do whatever they want. Or, if you prefer, it is crazy to consider the coalition with extreme left and extreme right. And they did this in two different ways, of course. Myerson had this idea. He associates to each agent a node of a graph. And then he puts some connection among these nodes. And the idea is the following. Suppose that you consider this coalition. This includes two agents that are not directly connected or indirectly connected the same in the subgraph related only to these two nodes. So, the conclusion of Myerson is that the worth of this coalition is not, if you are speaking for instance of a weight and majority situation, it is not the sum of the seats of the two parties. But you have to see this party is winning, if one of the two parties is winning, the coalition is winning, otherwise they are separated. It is, in a sense, we are considering that they don't vote in the same way. So we cannot sum their seats, their votes. Okay, this is the idea of Myers. Clearly, if you consider this coalition, we will be on this point at the end of the talk, these three agents are connected, so you can sum the votes of these three agents. If they are over the quota, it is a winning coalition, otherwise it is a losing coalition, this is another story. It's okay? The idea of Owen is a little bit different. He considers the problem that he wants to solve is what is the power of the single members of a parliament. As I said before, at the first reading you can think that all the parliamentary are equivalent because all of them have a vote. But in a sense the idea of Owen is this one. Yes, I can vote yes or no to a proposal, but if I belong to a party that is in favor, I should vote yes. And if I am in a party that is against the proposal, I should vote no. So I have some constraints, in a sense. This idea is in order to take into account this matter. And the easiest way, in my opinion, to make clear what are the a priori unions is more or less the following. I said you, for introducing the Shapley-Shubik index, I start to ask to every one of you if you are in favor or not, and I determine if an agent is critical or not according a given ordering. And as I said before, the Shapley-Shubik index takes into account all the possible orderings. The idea of Owen is not to take into account only all the possible orderings, but only these orderings in which the agent that belongs to the same a priori union, just to be clear, to the same party, are questioned consecutively in any possible order. Suppose that this is a party, this is another party. I decide I want to start with this, or I want to start with this. I take any ordering, but I first conclude all this one, and then I pass to the other, or vice versa. If I start with this, I first question them in any possible ordering, and then I pass to the other one. So in a sense, I reduce the number of orderings that are feasible, and I obtain a different result, the index of Owen. This is just to say something that can be added or was added in the following. Of course, Owen went on this his idea, taking into account not only a priori unions but making also some analysis what happens when you use the idea of Myerson for computing the Shapley-Shubik and the Banzhaf index. Another interesting development of the idea of Owen is due to Winter, that introduced the so-called level structure. As I said before, we can think of the idea of Owen as something like this. I have all the members of the parliament, for instance. Some of them forms parties. And I can ask to these members in any order with the Shapley-Shubik index, but if I use the Owen index, I have to select first one of these parties and ask to all of them in any ordering, and so on. Okay, the idea of Winter is to extend at other levels. For instance, something like this. What does it mean? Does it mean that with Owen I can question first this party, then this? According to Winter, if I start with this party, I have to continue with this one, because at the upper level it is required that they are contiguous. Then I can start with this. If I start with this, I have to continue with this. This means that, in a sense, I again reduce the number of ordings that are feasible. So I have different power. The last is a result of 8 years ago, in which the idea that in a situation can exist a priori unions, the parties in a parliament, but exist also communication structures, the idea of Owen, of Myerson, This means that some agents doesn't speak among themselves. This means that it does not form a coalition. Okay, in 1978 there was a strong change in the definition of power index. In a sense, if you look at the definition that I will give in the following slide, we can do this also without taking into account the game. So, in a sense, these indices are a little bit less than theoretical, but that I will present you the definition of these indices taking into account the coalition, so something related to game theory. The main idea is the following. According to Deegan and Packel, that are the first in a sense that used this idea, it is stupid to consider coalitions that in which not all the players are critical. The idea is, I have the cake to divide, the cake is the power. If I have more people that participate in the division of the cake, it is clear that each of them receive a little bit less. So why to have a wide coalition? It is better to have the coalition formed by as few parties as possible. Probably I receive a larger part of the cake. So the interest of Deegan and Packard is only on this coalition, the one in which all the agents are critical. The idea of Johnston is that we allow also for some coalitions in which not all the agents are critical. Someone are, someone not. Apparently, as I said, it is stupid to take into account this kind of coalition, because you have some members that are not necessary for reaching the majority, but in a sense they participate to the division of the cake. The Italian politics provided a very good example of this, where is an historical one, but it is another example of 2 weeks ago. I will present you, of course, the one of 2 weeks ago. I will use the names that for an Italian are very usual. I apologize that probably I say something that for you is very strange. But in this very moment, the Italian Parliament is strongly discussing about some reforms. And these reforms are very welcome by the parties of the majority, except a small part of the Democratic Party, that it is the party that has the relative majority and the party to which belong the president of the council, Matteo Renzi. It is called the minority of left. This minority of left is against this proposal. But there is another group that is in the opposition, that is in favor of this proposal. And this group is led by Verdini, that was previously a representative of the main party of the opposition, what in the time was called with different names, Partito delle Libertà, Popolo delle Libertà, Forza Italia, something like this, in any case related to Berlusconi, but I suppose that it is a name very famous, at least for football, if not for politics, or for other reasons, maybe. In Italian it's very famous for other reasons. Okay. The situation is the following. Clearly, if the group of Verdini and the minority of the left vote against the reform doesn't pass. But it is not necessary that both of them vote. This means that these two agents are not critical. The party of the Democratic Party is clearly critical. The so-called Scelta Civica is another critical party, but these two small amount of members of the parliament are not critical at all. So why they asked for rejecting this reform, and then they vote in favor, for a very simple reason. Because, in a sense, they want to guarantee that in the following they can participate to the division of the future cakes, not of the present cakes. Another question at this point. But the parties that are in the majority and that are critical, why should accept this situation? Because they can say, okay, if one of you stay out, it is better for me. I divide in three instead of in four. Of course, the situation is so recent that it is not known, at least for the people of Italy, probably they know very well, which is the real situation. So I switched to the past situation. The past situation was in what in Italy was called the First Republic, this means until 94. During the 80s, more or less all the majorities of the government were supported by Christian Democracy plus four small parties. In fact, the government was called Pentapartito, five parties. And the four small parties were not critical, but they were very useful for the Democratic Party, for the Christian Democracy, for this reason. They are not critical, so they accept a very small amount of power. It is better than nothing. If they were exactly four parties and all of them were critical, the Christian Democracy should ask more or less for one-fourth of the power. In this way, it was able to get more than half of the power, giving to the others more or less 10% of the power. So, the idea of a quasi-critical winning coalition, winning coalition. This means the coalition in which not all the agents are critical, can be exploited very well from the critical parties. The other receive something, but not so much if they were critical. Then, inspired in a sense by what was said before by Dingane and Packel, where is the so-called public good index of Manfred Oller, which consider what he called the winning decisive set. The main idea is the worth of a coalition is a public good. So, if a coalition is decisive, and in particular considered only the winning decisive set, it is not important if we are a lot in this coalition, if I have a lot of seats in the parliament. It is just see as a possibility that you have to impose your idea. So they simply take into account how many times I'm able to impose my idea. And now in the formal version it is more easy probably to understand. So we introduce these two definitions, minimal winning coalition and quasi-minimal winning coalition. The first is the one that is needed for Dingane Packel. And the idea is more or less the following. For each agent I consider all the minimal winning coalition in which I is a member of. Then I consider the number of minimal winning coalition. This one. This means that I divide the unitary power equally among all the minimal winning coalition. Inside each of the minimal winning coalition, I divide equally, this is the number of agents in SJ, the power assigned to that coalition. Then, for each agent, I collect all the small amount of party that he receives in the possible winning coalition in which it can enter. The result is the Dingane-Packel index. The idea of Johnston is more or less the same. Simply, we take into account the minimal winning coalition, the quasi minimal winning coalition, in which player I belongs, and it is also decisive, it is also critical for. And the same, we divide it among the number of quasi minimal winning coalition, and inside each quasi minimal winning coalition, we equally share the power only among the critical agents, not all of them. Just to say, it is clear that if the set of minimal winning coalition and quasi minimal winning coalition coincide, the two index coincide. The idea of the public good index is strongly related to the idea of the unpacking, but here we take into account the number of parties in the minimal winning coalition. Here it never appears. You simply consider that an agent belongs to several winning coalition. The more minimal winning coalition, the more are this minimal winning coalition, the more is the power of the agent. It is just a possibility to impose the idea, nothing else. Not taking into account anything about this. Okay. In the following year, we have another strong change that depends from the following remark. When we consider a weighted majority situation, we identify a party or an agent with just the weight. Sometimes it is too few to differentiate. We have two parties in a parliament, they have the same numbers of seats. You suppose that they should receive the same power, but sometimes it is not so. What happens? Happens something that, according to Kalai and Samet, means that they have a different weight. What is this weight? It is another parameter. Weight is just a name, it is nothing else. So, this means that I can in a sense, differentiate more the agents, not only the weight, but not only the number of seats that they have, but something more. So I introduce something more complicated, but it is more related to the situation that I have to consider. After the idea of Kalai and Samet, where is the idea of Heringer, that takes into account also communication structure. In fact, this is called weighted Meyerson index. And this year, Kese and Kalmanskaya apply the idea of the weights to the Degan-Pakel index. So this means that ideas growing continuously. Okay. Now I say something about this idea. The so-called restricted cooperation. In a sense, this is an extension of the idea of Meyerson. What is it? Not all the coalition are possible. This is a generalization of the idea of Meyerson. In particular, this group of authors deals with the situation of permission structure. This means that some coalitions are permitted, some others no. And introduce two permission indices, one that is called conjunctive, the other disjunctive. The idea that differentiates the situation is if you need all the agents to approve something, or some agents can act separately. The most simple example of conjunctive and disjunctive, always for the Italian situation, I don't know how is here in Spain, is if you have a bank account. In Italy there exists the so-called firma congiunta, firma disgiunta. What does it mean? The first disgiunta related to this is that any of the members of the owners of the account can operate separately from the others. Conjunctive means that if you want to make any you need all the people that own the account. The idea is more or less the same. The idea of this other group of authors is instead to take into account that not all the coalitions are feasible, but they introduce some constraints. that in the last slide I will present you as an open problem, which are these structures that they consider. This means the convex geometries and the antimatroids. Simply that you provide, in a sense, a path for each agent from the singleton to the grand coalition. This means that I can join to other players and forming larger coalition until at the end I form the grand coalition. But the way in which can add the different agents has a strongly constrained path. Exactly the convex geometries and the antimatroids. You cannot do whatever you want, but you have some constraints. If you are interested in this, there is this very nice survey that I strongly suggest you to read, if you are interested, and even if you are not particularly interested in it. Okay, just to say that I do something in this topic, nothing else. The idea of contiguity and connection. The first idea is, in a sense, not completely new. Hammer and Carreras already spoke about this. What is the idea of monodimensionality? The parties of a parliament lie on a line, on a segment, more precisely, 0, 1, that is called the left-right axis. You put the different parties in different points according if they are extreme left or extreme right parties. And according to Hammer and Carreras, the idea is that parties can stay in the same coalition if the distance on this axis is not so much. In this first paper, the idea was the following. We consider a set of coalitions that are contiguous. What does it mean? If I have in the same coalition two parties, all the parties that are in between should stay in the same coalition. Note that this hypothesis that apparently is strong, it is not so strong always for the Italian situation, in which sometimes it happens that some parties form a coalition, a majority coalition, but they need an help, and the help comes from the opposition, for instance this party. Clearly, apparently they are not contiguous, so it is a very strong hypothesis, the idea of contiguity. But what happens often in Italy is that the members of this party change their seats, they sit here. So they became contiguous not only from a technical point of view, but also from a physical point of view. They sit contiguously in the parliament. So this idea is strange, but not so much. At least I repeat for Italy. I don't know in other places what happens exactly. So the idea of contiguity is nice, according to us at least. The rest is more or less, you see, like the idea of Degan-Pakel. But this is the basis. The basis is that I equally share the power among the contiguous coalition and inside each coalition among the parties that belongs to this coalition, independent if they are critical or not. The generalization is that I can use not an equal distribution of the power among the coalition, I can use any distribution of power, and I can distribute the power in any possible way inside each coalition. For example, I can take into account the number of seats, I can take into account if they have, for instance, the president of the council. I don't know. There are several possibilities that you can decide. In fact, for this reason, we speak of a family instead of a power index, simply. Clearly, this definition strongly depends from the hypothesis of the monodimensionality. So, in a following paper, we decide to substitute contiguity with the concept of connection. So, again, we consider a graph. If the parties are connected, we have a connected coalitions that can be taken into account, and then things go exactly as in the first paper, in a sense. What is, in a sense, according to us, really new is that non-contiguous for the first case and non-connected coalition for the second case does not exist at all. And in fact, these are the conclusion of my talk, in a sense, what happens with infeasibility of some coalition. I start with a very simple example. This is a weighted majority situation. We have four parties. Each of them has this number of seats in the parliament, and the majority is 51. It is easy to see that some coalition are winning and some other are losing, of course. Then we can introduce a graph according to the idea of Meyerson. This means that party 4 is completely isolated. In Italy this happens, I don't know in Spain. For example, in the 70s it was usual for the extreme right party, the so-called Movimento Sociale, was rejected by anybody. It has a lot of seats in the parliament. At a certain moment it reached more than 10%, but nobody wanted to form a coalition with him. While the other three parties are in this situation. The question that I pose here is more or less the following. What you read from this graph? You read that clearly coalition 1-2 is feasible, they are connected. You read that coalition 2-3 is feasible, they are connected. The problem is when you, and clearly 1 and 3 are not compatible, so the coalition is not feasible, they are not connected. The problem is what happens with coalition 1-2-3. According to the idea of Meyerson, this coalition is feasible because they are connected indirectly, but they are connected. But it is clear that if party 1 and 3 does not communicate among themselves, it is also possible that they don't want to stay in the same coalition, even if it is player 2. So the simplest idea is, okay, if this coalition is feasible, I put another arc, otherwise no. But if I put another arc, implicitly I say coalition 1-3 is feasible. This problem should be solved in some way. I propose here a very, very simple way to solve it. Look at the graph. Clearly, 1 and 3 are not feasible. Then you ask yourself, 1-2-3 is feasible or not? Then you can ask to a panel of experts. Or perhaps you can look what happens in the past. Maybe it is better to look at the recent past. If they often form a coalition, it is feasible. If they never form a coalition, it is not feasible. The second question is in a sense related to the idea that I said you of feasibility with a restricted cooperation, for instance. If you look at coalition 1-2-3, according to Meyerson, 1-2 are connected, 4 is unconnected, so you have to assign to this coalition the sum of the worth of the two coalitions. This coalition is winning, so the value of this coalition is winning. If you are computing the Meyerson value, that it is nothing else but the Shapley value for the restricted game, you look at player 2 and say, okay, coalition 1-4 is losing. Coalition 1-2-4 is winning. Player 2 is critical. In a sense, we have a swing. But the question that we pose is, what does it mean that 2 has a swing? It produces a winning coalition that is not feasible. It is very strange, in my opinion, just to be clear, that a coalition is winning but not feasible. I suppose that it should be first feasible, and then we can ask it is winning or not. The difference with respect to the structure proposed by Bilbao, Gaba, and so on, is that we consider all the possible situations in which a collision is infeasible. Somehow happens that a collision is infeasible. What to do at this point? It is an open problem. I think not for the world, but for me it is an open problem. Just to be very clear. I think that there is not a lot of people that doesn't sleep for this question, but me too, I sleep very well. But I would like to solve this in a good way, of course. Okay, these are the list of references if you want to look at them. It is very long. Thank you very much for your attention. If you have questions, they are very welcome. Not only in this very moment, but I stay here until 11 I leave, until 10 of November. You can find me on the other, on the opposite side of the building in that direction. That's all. Thank you very much. Nobody slept, it is good. Nobody left, it is good the same.
Please. You always model the unidimensional continuity, or because in Spain, from my point of view, we have bidimensional continuity.
Yes.
Because we have another axis, which is nationalist, non-nationalist of parties.
Until some years ago, the answer is yes. Now it is not so clear, because there is more or less the same problem, the Northern League, Lega Nord, that introduces something like nationalism. They want to separate the north of Italy from the south, and even if the Northern League is a left, right party, so it is not so difficult to have the monodimensionality, if you want, because it is more on the right than on the left, this idea of divide Italy. It is not so strong in the other right parties, so that a bidimensional model could be better. In fact, when I told here, in this point we passed to connection, the starting point was exactly the matter that even if Northern League is on the right, in 94 they decided to support the government led by the Communist Party. I don't remember exactly the name at that moment, because in Italy the Communist Party changed the name, I think, more or less 6 times in 3 years. So you have to know at which hour we are speaking of, and I can say the name of the parties in this moment, because otherwise 10 minutes later it is another name, just to say the Communist Party. Why? It is completely unknown, of course, because one is on one side, have some ideas, the Northern League has completely different ideas, but simply they want to carry on the situation, nothing else. And at that moment we say, okay, we cannot say that they are contiguous, it is better to think to the idea of connection. So this is the idea for which we consider more than one dimension. Of course, in this at this point you can have any number of dimensions that you want. But just to revert to your question, now the monodimensionality is a little bit too strong, probably, in Italy. Not so much, but a little bit, yes. But only for the Northern League. The others are more or less ordered.
Any other question?
Do you find applications in other fields, for instance, in engineering or communications?
Yes, just to say some situation that involved me directly. So I speak of something that I know, nothing else. The Shapley-Shubik index was used for evaluating the relevance of the genes as a marker of disease. The more is the power, the more a gene is important as a marker of a disease, not necessarily a genetic disease, any kind of disease. Some of the research were made on cancer, but usually it is not a genetic disease. But there are some diseases that influence, strongly influence what is called the level of expression of a gene. This means that usually if you take a sample from a normal person, you have a certain percentage of a gene. If this person has a disease, it is possible that the disease influences the expression and it is abnormal. Where abnormal could be, it is so overexpressed, this means this gene multiplicate a lot, or underexpressed, this means that this gene in a sense disappear. So, if you have that a gene is strongly abnormally expressed, this is a marker of a situation. It is considered from the medical point of view, not again theoretic, as a marker that the person could have the disease. Just to speak about statistics, what is different among statistics and game theory in this case is that statistics simply counts simply. I apologize. but when you count the number of situation which the gene is abnormally expressed, you don't take into account the what is called the relative influences of the two genes. Maybe a gene is over or under expressed, not due to the disease, but because there is another gene that it is abnormally expressed, and there is a strong influence on the other genes. The idea of using game theory is that you can realize this situation. So the second gene is abnormally expressed not because you have a disease, but in view of the first gene. Of course, from a medical point of view, it is more or less the same. If the first gene is overexpressed, also the second gene is overexpressed, so the matter that the first gene is overexpressed is a marker of the disease and also the second. But if you know that the first gene could be abnormally expressed, even if the disease is not present, the second is no longer a marker of the disease. Simply said, the first gene is abnormally expressed, nothing else. So this could be a small advantage of game theory with respect to statistics. And for instance, about this, there are several papers of a lot of authors, and among them there is Stefano Moretti, that you know. And he worked in Cancer Unity in Genova, and the medical group appreciated his work. So, probably the idea is not so bad. I hope that it is also good, in a sense. And of course there are several other situations. For instance, also, from a point of view, if you want to launch an advertising campaign, you can measure if the influence of this campaign on the customers using, for instance, power indices. If they change their mind due to the campaign is good. Otherwise, you have to change something. So there are several situations which power indices can be very well used. Of course, politics is the basis. Stakeholders is the second. And there are a lot of other situations. This is, just to say, this is the world of power index. And this is the part that I expressed you, more or less, probably less. Okay?
Any other question?
So thank you very much.
Thank you for the hospitality.